determine in the future the bulk of the public and the private investment for the next 3 decades. The question of energy, the question of food, the question of water, the question of climate change. Investments are going to go that way. And out of our public-private dialogue. Are we aware of that? Are we teaching our students about that? And let's take the third point about this apolitic in the world. Out of that, I mean, it's very clear that in many states, the situation, the political situation has changed, and a new law, a new industrial policy, a new court judgment, you know, can really influence very directly the results of a company. Companies have to learn at this moment to manage the public sphere in this new political context. Do we teach our students about dialogue with the stakeholders and dialogue with the governments or with the policymakers as a very important aspect, directly related to the results of the company? I think that we have, you know, a long way to go concerning these questions. And that's why, you know, this new phenomenon that we have in front of us is an urgency to the question of sustainability as a new horizon for business education. So let's ask ourselves, in this situation, how are the business education sector reacting? Well, you see that as well as I do. Sustainability has become a major recurrent focus of business schools' international conferences. I mean, in my capacity as representing Pride, I have gone around for the last 2 years, and there's no single international conference where this topic has not been raised. Secondly, I would say that there is a new generation of deans focused on sustainability issues. And maybe the most paradigmatic is the new dean of Harvard, Nitin Loria, recently elected. Well, Nitin Loria doesn't come from the traditional fields of deans in Harvard, and that goes back, as you know, more than 100 years. He is not a former professor of finances, a former professor of strategy. He comes from leadership and sustainability. Now, why? Well, there was an article in the Financial Times of an emeritus professor in Harvard trying to explain this change, trying to explain this option, and he was saying that, in fact, you know, what is very alive at this moment in Harvard is the question of what are we doing? What is Harvard contributing to the solution of the world's most important problems? And precisely, you know, this type of question is the one that has made, well, let's choose, let's change direction. Let's make out of Harvard something that has been lost in the past. And I would say that out of this urgency also we are seeing, you know, the emergence of new initiatives like, initiatives like the Global MBA, like, you know, the sustainability index of the Aspen Institute, initiatives like the Globally Responsible Leadership Initiative, GRLI, the revival and growth of the net impact aspect chapters, you know, throughout the world of this, students' organization that really defends the question of sustainability, and along with the impact, OICOS, the sustainability report that is going to be presented today of our association, of the IAJES, the sustainability group that has emerged with a lot of strength within ACSB. Other things that are in store at this moment, ABBA, the Association of MBAs, is at this moment updating the standards, the accreditation standards, along the lines of sustainability, and with the participation of Pride into this exercise. The Professional Oath Project is another of these things that are happening at this moment, and also Pride, the Principle for Responsible Management Education, as an all-inclusive initiative. So let me talk very briefly about the Principles for Responsible Management Education. The Principles for Management Education, they were born in July 2007 when a group of 60 deans and professionals, from professors and scholars from all over the presented, we presented to Ban Ki-moon, to the Secretary General of the United Nations, these principles. In fact, we have had a task force from the previous 6 months in 2007 drafting these principles. So that was the moment in which, you know, PRIME was born. PRIME, like, you know, defined like a global call to change the curriculum, research, and learning methods of management education, incorporating at the core of what we do in our business schools, the vision, the tools, and the skills, the values of the United Nations Global Goal. And those values, as I said before, relate to human rights, to labor standards, to the environmental care, to the anti-corruption, to the challenge of the world. The principles themselves are very simple, and I will go very quickly over them. In the declaration, many of you are already participants, we say, as institutions of higher education involved in the development of current and future managers, we declare our willingness to progress in the implementation within our institution of the following principles. And it says, we will report on the progress to all our stakeholders and exchange effective practices related to these principles with other academic institutions. So the principles are six, very briefly. The first one is a mission statement. Really refers to what is it all about in a business school from the point of view of this initiative. We have to teach our participants, our students, about a sustainable value for business and society at large. So I would say this is the most important core concept, you know, business and society. In other words, the positive impact in terms of the environment and the social impact of the company within society. And secondly, to work for an inclusive and sustainable global economy. Nothing less. This is really a huge change. Second principle. The second principle refers to the change in the curriculum. The third principle refers to the learning methods in our business schools. The fourth principle refers to research. The fifth principle refers to the needed engagement with responsible companies in our work, in our daily activities. And the sixth principle refers to open business schools. Business schools that are open to partnership for development, to partnership to fight poverty, to partnership to implement and to make progress in the millennium development goals, and so on and so forth. And at the end of the principle, there is this little sentence in which we say we understand that our own organizational practices should serve as an example of the values and attitudes we convey to our students. That means, you know, greening our business schools, lowering the carbon footprint in our business schools, and respecting in our business schools the human rights and the labor standards and so on that we are putting in our curriculum. Today, PRIME has 320 signatories around the world. Other important feature is that the credibility of the initiative is being created at this moment to reporting. There is no other way of, you know, having a serious initiative but by publicly stating the progress that is being done. So in PRIME, every 18 months, the school has to issue a report. And this report is not really, you know, kind of an obligation. On the contrary, it's the way of sharing information on progress and therefore making together a learning community. PRIME has a growing number of activities, anti-corruption groups, poverty as a challenge group, climate change group, travel studies group, learning methods groups, and so on and so forth. But one thing I would like to really, you know, highlight here is that almost all relevant associations in our sector are involved. There is NCSB as part of our conveners, EFMD, and the Association of MBAs, the three big accreditation bodies. There is the Jose for Latin American School of Negocios, the Latin American Council of Business Schools, the CIMA, the Central and Eastern European Management Association, a similar body. There is the African Association of Business Schools. But also, on board we have GRLI, Advanced Laboratories of Sustainability, with academia, like GRLI, like the ABIS, the Academy of Business Society, like the Aspenis Institute Business and Society Program, Net Impact, and of course, the United Nations Global Program. I have to say that, you know, to work with all these associations is wonderful. It means that everybody is concerned about sustainability as well. Just to highlight as an example, for instance, CIMA at this moment, you know, has done a wonderful survey about poverty as a challenge for business education, trying to do what we should do together, which is to legitimize poverty as part of our curriculum for the future. Well, this is the type of thing that is being done by our partners in Europe. And of course, the IAJBS is on board. So, I think that I'm going to skip some aspects because I explained myself, you know, over time, and I think I'm going to go into a problem or your dialogue very soon. But I would like to say to you that, you know, one of the questions about Prime is that many times I have seen that the Prime is somehow considered to participate in Prime as a recognition of what is already being done. And I think that this is very relevant for all of us. You know, if you see these principles, you will say, well, this is already what we are doing, so we are fine. We are, you know, working along that way. And I would like, you know, to send to you a word of caution. There was an article I would like to refer to at this moment. Is that in a country we were having an outreach event of Prime. And there was the dean of a business school of a Catholic denomination, was in a Jesuit. And he said very, very candidly to us, well, says, we recognize those principles, says, we have this type of values, we do nothing. So, because we do nothing. Well, certainly, you know, I was thinking at the moment, this school never, ever will be able to answer the question that was put to Harvard. How, and in what extent, how specifically I am contributing to the solution of the big problems of the world? How I am answering to the global agenda as well? How I am educating in a systematic way my students to understand that business and society in the 21st century go together. So I think that this is a very important aspect I wanted to, you know, to present to you. And just to refer immediately to what I would like to call the Jesuit advantage. In my own experience, although I have to say that my experience in my own business school is just 3 months, so I'm very green going into this, but looking around, going around the world, and seeing the reactions of many Jesuit business schools, I have seen that the principles resonate very well with the work that is already being done. Why? I think that there are 2 basic arguments here. The first one is that the Jesuit tradition is values-based education. And that's precisely what is needed today. And because after all, Prime and the Global Compact is nothing but a values-based proposition for the 21st century, that really connects with your tradition, that really connects to what is quintessential for us, that is a values-based education. That's the first aspect. And the second aspect I would say is that the Jesuit underlying philosophy of leadership, and I would say stemming directly from the Ignatian tradition, could be summarized as to innovate with confidence.